8, 23 through 27. Treasure hunting has always been an exciting storyline. There are countless tales about pirates and buried treasure being hidden away on some remote island that can only be found by those who know where it is. As imaginative as most of these legends are, there really are treasure hunters in the world even still today. Most of them are not looking for treasure that's buried on a remote island, however, but rather treasure that has been long lost at the bottom of the sea. These modern treasure hunters scour the high seas in search of the buried cargo of sunken vessels from antiquity. There are many modern methods to search for such treasure, but there is one particular time when treasure hunters are most eager to head out to sea, and that is directly following a great storm. When powerful storms stir up the waters of the ocean, they often stir up things long settled on the seabed as well. Storms have a tendency to uncover things buried deep down. As the wind and the waves thrash about, things formerly veiled by a veneer of sediment become exposed. In fact, it is through the powerful effects of storms that many new important discoveries have actually been made. Beloved, this is not only true for the ocean floor, but it is also true for the human heart. When the storms of life swell about us, the depths of our hearts are often stirred up and exposed. Things long hidden are brought up to the surface. This was certainly true for these young disciples in our story today, and we will soon see that it is true for our own hearts as well. These young disciples had left behind their former lives in order to follow Jesus. But what they did not realize is how much of their former lives they still carried with them in their hearts. They did not realize that their faith, though sincere, was still a shallow, fair-weather faith. They did not realize that deep in their hearts remained crippling doubts, fears, apprehensions, and suspicions that drug along like a heavy and gnarled anchor, hindering them in their forward progress to learn to live fully surrendered to the Lord Jesus Christ. In order to discover these hidden things in their hearts, the Master Jesus Christ would have to take his beloved disciples on a little trip out to the sea. And that's where our text begins today. Please stand with me now for the reading of God's holy word. Beginning in verse 18. Now when Jesus saw, beginning in verse 23. Unless you want to hear last week's sermon again. Verse 23. And when he got into the boat, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great storm on the sea, so that the boat was being swamped by the waves. But he was asleep. And they went and woke him, saying, "Save us, Lord, we are perishing." And he said to them, "Why are you afraid, O you of little faith?" Then he rose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. And the men marveled, saying, "What sort of man is this, that even winds and sea obey him?" Thus ends the reading of God's word. May he bless it this morning for his own name. Please be seated. Verse 23 begins to pick up where verse 18 had left off. It says, when he got into the boat, his disciples followed him. If you remember back in verse 18, which I almost read to you a moment ago, Jesus had said, it's time to depart. But something interrupted that departure. That was the text we looked at last week. Jesus had given the command to go to the other side, but before that departure, he was approached by two would-be followers. To both of them, Jesus expressed the high cost of being a true disciple. He showed them that he must be trusted as nothing less than Lord of all in our heart if we are truly to live the obedient Christian life. In two different ways, Jesus issued the hard terms of true discipleship and beckoned them to follow him. We now read here in 23 that the boats were departing. A line had in fact been drawn, a distinction had been made. Some had rejected the call of Christ. They were unwilling to receive his terms, and so they stayed behind. They kept the comfortable life that they had enjoyed in this world. Others had accepted Christ's call to follow him and willingly climbed into the boats in order to be near to their master. They had just entered the difficult school of true discipleship, and class was about to be called to session. Comparative to those who chose to stay behind, these men had something of a settled commitment to Christ and a professed willingness to surrender all to him as Lord. They trusted him. They were ready to follow wherever he may go, or at least so they thought. And then the storm comes, doesn't it? And then this commitment begins to be tested right away. And in verse 24, what we see is that, behold, there arose a great storm in the midst of this sea crossing. A great storm so that the boat was being swamped by the waves. Now, these men who had followed Jesus for the most part were fishermen. They were men of the sea. They knew how to handle themselves on the waters. This would not have been the first storm that they had faced. But there was something different about this storm, something far more powerful. And that's why we see there that it was not just a storm, but a great storm. A storm so powerful that it would empty men of their courage. Even seafaring men of experience would find their knees weak and ready to buckle at the view and at the wind and at the waves and at the thrashing of what they now faced. Suddenly, their plans for a smooth trip across the sea were dashed by unexpected circumstances. And I believe that even here at the beginning of our text, we can find how much we relate. How many times in this life that we face unexpected circumstances ourselves. That as we set out to do one thing where we're expecting perhaps calm seas, a serene passage, something simple, something easy, something we even maybe enjoy, and suddenly we find ourselves facing struggles or battling through unforeseen circumstances. And in the process of this life, as we make life's journey, we find ourselves experiencing pain and loss and tragedy. Like these disciples, we can suddenly face a storm that we didn't see coming. We can begin to be thrashed about by a cancer diagnosis or a life-altering injury. We can be thrashed about by crippling depression or anxiety. We can be thrashed about by the experience of loss or of betrayal from someone whom we trusted deeply. Marital strife, wayward children, natural disasters like tornadoes or fires, many of which have been taking place in regions around our nation, even in this past week. Homes destroyed overnight, flooded, ruined. All that was precious to those people in the world washed away in an instant. And what about inflated economies and the rising costs of living? What about wars and rumors of wars? And the what-ifs of evil men and evil regimes in this world. Beloved, in a fallen world, storms come upon us quickly and often. And when they do, they shake our sense of peace. Like these men, no matter how experienced we may think ourselves to be, not one of us is fit to face the realities of life in a fallen world on our own or with our own strength. We all know deep in our hearts that there's something more needed if we are to make it, if we are to make it through the storms of life. And when the boat of our life begins taking on water, our hearts are often gripped with doubt and fear. And these times, our faith is especially tried and sifted. Can you imagine the disciples? Imagine them standing on the shore, hearing Jesus in the previous passage give out these hard terms of discipleship. And you can imagine, though, they would want a humble exterior, that maybe there's a little inside them of, you know, we're the real followers. We're the people who really trust you. And so they get into the boat, and maybe their heads are held a little higher, their chests are out a little bit, and they're feeling like maybe we're a cut above. Maybe there's something about us that is good. And suddenly the storm comes, and you can almost overhear the conversation in their hearts, can't you? Why did I get in the boat? Why did I get in the boat? I should have stayed on the shore. And haven't you felt that? Haven't you felt that moment when the collision of reality and of your trust in God come together? And in the moments before you, you can't seem to reconcile the two, and you're struggling. That's where these men were. Every visible sense of security and safety that they knew was sinking before their eyes. In the midst of the fray, they turned to see the one that they have left the safety of the shore to follow, the one whom they have placed their trust in. And what do they see when they turn their eyes to Jesus? Look at the text with me. As the storm has come and the boat is being swamped by the waves, where is Jesus? He's asleep. Picture this scene, beloved. Don't miss this. And in fact, if you were to look at Mark's gospel, it tells us just a little bit more about Jesus. He wasn't just asleep. He was asleep on the cushion. While his disciples, those who had followed him, those who had put their trust on him, those who had given up their comforts of life here in this world, had got into the boat because they trusted, and where are they? They're suffering under the waves. And where is Jesus? He's asleep on the cushion. What do you do in that moment? You remember how I began telling you about how the storms in the sea tend to shift things around and expose some things within us and bring up to the surface, as it were, things hidden? What is your attitude toward Christ in that moment, dear Christian? What comes out of you? Because it was already there. This storm did not put anything new into these disciples' hearts. It revealed, it brought forth, it exposed what was already there, and it does in your life and in mine as well. And as they look upon the slumbering, comfortable Jesus, as the winds and the waves are battering them, they must have felt as though God had gone for a nap and forgotten them. And we often feel that way. We feel in our suffering and in our struggles, in the storms of life, we feel as though God has abandoned us. Sometimes we feel as though God has revoked his love, that the promise was not true, that we shouldn't have believed, that maybe it was a deception, maybe it was a lie. Why have I put all of my hope in this one who seems to be asleep in the midst of my struggle? Jesus is a really, really good teacher. He is a brilliant teacher, beloved. And he has sovereignly orchestrated this moment for his disciples. We must remember, to be a disciple is to be a learner. Jesus didn't call them to be disciples, and they said, sure, and then that's sort of the end. That was the beginning. The beginning of a life of being trained and sanctified and instructed and taught true doctrine and true holiness and what the mission of the Christian church is in the world. They had begun something, not ended something. And Jesus calls class to session. He brings them into the boat. He takes them to the sea and sovereignly orchestrates an event in which we might capture it this way. It's as if Jesus is saying to his disciples, it's as if he's saying to them while he sleeps here in the midst of the storm and all of those doubts in their hearts come forth, it's as if he's saying, you have said that you trust me and that you will follow me wherever I lead you. But what will you do when letting go of the world and following me is the very thing that leads you into the storm? What will you do when it is your very obedience to my will that brings you into hardship in this world? Will you still trust me then? Will you trust me in the face of suffering? I'm going to speak more about this later on, but I want to give a plug. Remember where Matthew's gospel is headed. Where does his gospel conclude? The Great Commission. He is not content to have a self-centered faith in Jesus that stops there. The Christian not only puts personal faith in Christ, but personally follows Christ on his mission in this world. And Jesus is preparing his disciples to walk out that hard mission. He's got them in the classroom now to begin to teach them, what will you do when it's hard? What will you do when it looks like I'm asleep and you can't make sense of what's happening about you? As the great storm thrashes against the ocean floor of the disciples' hearts, what do we find hidden underneath? Let me read to you verse 25. They went and woke him, saying, "Save us, Lord. We are perishing." When sifted by the winds and waves, the shallow limits of the disciples' present faith are laid bare. When sifted by the winds and waves, the shallow limits of the disciples' present faith are laid bare. Though their faith is sincere, it is weak and immature. It is easily toppled by a change in the weather. Have you ever recognized that about this text? Literally, a change in the weather has brought out of them great doubt. Now, you might say, wait a minute, what was wrong with their response? What's the problem with 25? Save us, Lord. We are perishing. What else should they have said, you might ask? I've asked that question. I read the text and I go, what's the problem? Isn't that what we should say? Isn't that what we should do? We should look to Jesus and trust him to be the Savior. But the problem is, we can tell by Jesus' response that they were not asking because they trusted, because they believed. Look what Jesus says, verse 26, and he said to them, "Why are you afraid, O you of little faith?" When Jesus says that, it's a very gentle way of the Savior addressing a very real problem in the hearts of his disciples. What does he cite as the error or the problem in their heart at this moment? It is little faith. Little faith. What Jesus recognizes in their cry is that they're not asking because of confidence in him, but because of doubt in him. And we can confirm this again from Mark's gospel, where we read the same story. And in that gospel, we get a little bit longer list of what the disciples had actually said. And one of them, in the midst of the storm, they didn't simply say, "Save us, O Lord, we are perishing." One of them cried out and said, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" That gets to the heart of it, doesn't it? Isn't that what the scene looks like? Isn't that what you feel in the midst of the storms that you face? God, do you care about me? Where are you, O Lord? You see, their cry was not a cry of faith in God's goodness in the midst of the storm. Their cry was a cry of doubt about God's goodness because of the storm. It was not a cry of faith in God's goodness in the midst of the storm. It was a cry of doubt about God's goodness because of the storm. And I really find in my life, and perhaps in yours, that that drives right to the heart of it for me. Right to the heart of it. That I allow those things on the outside, those temporal things, those fleeting things, to hold greater weight in determining my view of God than the unchanging eternal truths of who God actually is. In other words, the way we often interpret reality is completely backwards and lopsided. We look at the fleeting and the temporary to determine the eternal, instead of the eternal and unchanging to rightly understand the temporary. What had changed? Had Jesus changed since they left the shore? Had God's promises to them changed? Had the terms of discipleship changed? No. The only thing that had changed was the weather. Temporal earthly circumstances had changed. And the storm exposed something hidden in the hearts of these young disciples, as well as our own hearts, beloved. And I urge you not to resist seeing this morning. What it exposed is that within the hearts of these young disciples, as well as within our own, is a shallow, fair-weather faith that if unaddressed, we'll never trust Christ enough to live out the church's costly mission in this world. Don't miss this. Don't miss this. We often read this text, and I mean this with kindness, and I don't mean to take away the good part of this, but we read this text and we find the terminus or the climax of this text is just my personal comfort, that I'll feel better about my storm. I hope you do feel better about your storm. We should get that from this text. But discipleship is not about you. This is about the Lord. It is His world. It is His kingdom. It's His glory. Disciples follow Him to do His will so that He would be exalted. And the end of Jesus' discipleship here is not so that the disciples will go, I feel happy inside about my little life, but so that they would give up their little life to follow the King of Kings in His mission in this world. And what this storm is bringing out of them and brings out of us as we walk through them is a shallow, fair-weather faith that if unaddressed, we'll never trust Christ enough to live out the church's costly mission in this world. And why will it not do that? Because it will be too busy clutching after this world for security. Do you see that in your life? Do you feel that in your heart? I certainly do. I find these things present not only in the text of Scripture, but right here. And I believe that discipleship for me and for you, to be in the school of Christ, to be being trained up to follow Christ in this world, means as those things are exposed, I need to take them to the Lord and ask Him to help me with my shallow, fair-weather faith that resists true surrender to the costly mission of Christ in this world. The storm uncovered that deep in their hearts, they still harbored remnants of unbelief and doubt and fears and qualified surrender. In other words, I'll follow you unless. Terms that they would impose upon the Almighty God of how far they will trust Him and how far they will go. Their doubting hearts were filled with some of the same questions that we so often ask ourselves in the storms. I've given you three, although we could write many. If Jesus is truly Lord, why is He letting me face this right now? Have you not heard that question in your own heart as you've suffered, as you've struggled? Why should I follow Christ if suffering is what it brings? Have you ever felt that echo in your soul? And finally, is it really worth it to lay down the treasures of this world to follow Jesus? Because make no mistake, you can't keep them and follow Jesus. You can't keep them and follow Jesus. Is it really worth it? Aren't these the questions that come out of us as the storms thrash about and move around the depths of our hearts? When we face storms, our hearts are full of many longings and questions, beloved. But perhaps these are the three primary ones. And there's always a risk here because suffering is a very difficult and deep thing. So I understand this is a bit oversimplified, but I can't cover everything in a sermon. So stick with me on these three points while I recognize they have many branches, okay? Three things, perhaps, three broad headings that come up in us as we face storms. There's the question of compassion. As we suffer, we often wonder, am I loved? How can God love me if He is allowing me to face this? I feel abandoned in the moment. I feel rejected. I feel forgotten. I feel cast off. Sometimes we might even say we feel betrayed or deceived. There's the question of authority. Can I be helped in the suffering I'm facing? Is there any remedy? Is there someone that is strong enough to deliver me from what I'm facing? Can anyone take this away from me? Thirdly, there's the question of purpose. Why is this happening to me? Why am I facing this? Is there some meaning to my pain? Are these not the things that well up in you as the storm comes, as you see the clouds gather and you feel the wind and you hear the crack of the thunder and the bolts of lightning illumine the sky and startle your soul? Is this not what you find as you look to God Where are you, Lord? Do you love me? Are you with me? And why have you led me here? All these things were present in the disciples' hearts, beloved, as they began to learn what it meant to follow Christ. And in verse 26b, Jesus answers these three questions for his disciples and for us. Then he rose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. Rather understated, if you ask me. What a beautiful picture. In the midst of the chaos and the fear and the doubt and the suspicion and the disarray and the hopelessness and sort of the melting courage of these seasoned sailors, Christ, with simplicity, with decision, without any limitation, without any fumbling through and trying to figure it out, he stands and acts and delivers his people. And he answers those questions, the question of compassion and of authority. And I will show you the answer to the question of purpose. First, we see that he rose and rebuked the winds and the sea. There's the compassion, beloved. He rose and rebuked the storm, despite the maligning doubts of his disciples. Let's pause there. Maybe you don't think that's very offensive. Maybe you think that your doubting of God is not very offensive. But I would encourage you to maybe take a moment to consider what it is that really your heart is throwing at the face of God in your unbelief. When you're doubting God, you are not simply doubting him in some sort of closet of innocence. You are accusing him of being insufficient, of being untrustworthy, of being not good, of being weak, of being toppled and overcome by something else. Our unbelief is an accusation. The unbelief of every sinner's heart is an accusation that defames the name of the holy God. And here Jesus says that's what the disciples were doing in verse 26. Their little faith was filled with suspicion and accusation about God. But what does Jesus do for those who are suspicious and doubting him and maligning his character? He stands and he rebukes the wind and he shows them his love in the face of their unbelief. He shows them his compassion. Remember that question, am I loved? Christ has answered it. He's not only answered it here, but he has answered it upon the cross, where he willingly paid the highest price for your redemption. We see the compassion. What about the authority? When Jesus rose and rebuked the winds and the sea, what happened to them? How did those winds and sea respond? There was a great calm. Remember, I said to you, this was not an ordinary storm. I said it could just say the word storm, but it doesn't. We see the word, the Greek word megalou, which refers to a great storm, a storm that would cause courageous seafaring men to panic. Well, that same word is applied to the response of creation to the voice of Christ. There was a great calm. Don't miss this, beloved. There has only ever been one who can speak to creation, and creation responds with perfect, unhindered, immediate obedience. Who is he? Who is the one in the boat with these sinful men? Who is the one who has come to save his people from their sins? The third question is the question of purpose. We ask when we suffer, why is this happening to me? And I want to put that question to you. This text does not immediately go there, but if you were to step back and look at the flow of Matthew's gospel, you will begin to see the good work of discipleship that Christ is doing. If you want to understand this text, the simplest way is this. The first half of the text is all about exposing the hearts of these disciples, exposing them, so that we can really see what's inside. The second half of the text is all about dealing with what was exposed, bringing remedy and healing and cure to that unbelief. That's what this text is about. So what was God's purpose? Why did he take his disciples through this? Before the storm, the disciples thought they had come to a strong, resolute faith. But Jesus knew better. He knew that their faith, though sincere, was still weak and immature. They had much to learn and a great need to grow. To be a follower of Christ is not merely about receiving our own salvation. It is also about living all of life on mission for God in this world, giving glory to his name and devoting ourselves to his purposes. Such a mission involves much loss and suffering. The path is marked by many personal sacrifices and persecutions. The way is paved with many storms. Jesus has said so, beloved. Jesus himself says, in this world you will have trouble. Paul says, everyone who desires to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. There is no way to live an uncostly Christianity. Christianity comes with cost. Christianity is a hard way. Jesus said so. There are sacrifices. There are storms. And fair weather faith will never be enough to move us out toward that mission, beloved. Immature faith will never be enough to cause us to step out and stand firm in the precious work of evangelism and disciple making. Instead, with weak and ignorant faith, we will be like the seed that fell among the thorns, which never came to harvest because it was ever choked by the fleeting cares of this world. I find that in my heart. And I want to, before I read the next bit here, I want to apply this in one particular way, pastorally. What is the thing that I find the church, not saying our church particularly, but the church today, most reluctant to lay down for the mission and cause of Christ? What is the thing that we want to cling to that we'll say, I'll give you everything else but not this? What is it? It is your reputation before men in this world. That's what it is. Everyone would love to be a Christian until it's time to speak hard Christian truth. And then they come up with all kinds of excuses to save their name instead of sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, knowing that many in this world will not want to hear it. Fair weather faith will keep us from laying our reputation down. It will keep us clutching to the world. And what Jesus does in this passage with his disciples, those who've chosen to follow him, those who are now in the boat on the way, Jesus intentionally brought these young disciples into the storm in order to expose what lay hidden in their hearts. But his purpose was not merely to expose what they lacked and then to leave them there. Thank God. Imagine if you had to just stare in the mirror, that somehow this mirror reflected back to you the sin of your heart with perfect clarity, and then you were never able to leave it. You were stuck to look upon your doubt, to look upon your suspicion, to look upon your sin with no hope, no remedy, no rescue. Jesus never leaves a sinner there. Many sinners choose to stay, however. But Jesus invites those whom he exposes in their guilt and exposes in their sin to not only behold who they are outside of him, but to come to him and receive God's forgiveness, receive his pardon, receive his mercy, receive his grace. He holds it forth freely to everyone who will come to him. And so Jesus here in the boat has brought this out of the disciples. He's exposed what they lacked, but he doesn't leave them there. He also addresses their doubts with a powerful demonstration of his own surpassing glory. Through the storm, Jesus showed them their weak faith. Has that happened to you? Have you come to that place where God has shown you the immature and ignorant and weak faith, the stunted growth of your faith? But what else did Jesus do? And what is he doing for you this morning? He not only showed them their weak faith, but then he showed them that their faith in him has absolutely no reason to ever be weak. How so? Beloved, Jesus spoke to the storm. That's the word of your King. That's the word of Christ. You need not be afraid to trust him in the Christian mission in this world. That's his power. He speaks and creation obeys. You need not be afraid to lay down your life for the cause of Christ. That's the message. That's the message that my soul so desperately needs. That's what it means to follow Christ. And that's what he is communicating to these, his precious, beloved disciples. He knows their doubts. He knows yours. He knows where you are, and he loves you. He will help you. He will walk with you. He'll take you on the boat for a little trip out to sea. But he won't leave you there. He will show you that he is worthy of your trust at every moment, at every hour, in every situation that you could ever possibly face. He is worthy of your trust and of your surrender. The troubled waters without, meaning on the outside of the disciples, as well as the troubled waters within, were brought to a great calm by the magisterial authority of the Lord Jesus himself. Notice what has happened in this passage. The great storm revealed great doubt. But what does the great calm do? The great calm produces great faith. The great storm revealed great doubt, and the great calm that Jesus works in 26b brings forth the great faith that we read about in verse 27. And the men marveled. The men marveled. Picture this scene with me. Men whose knees are so weak with fear and hearts are so full with doubt were suddenly strengthened and given resolution in the midst of the same sea in which they were formerly afraid. They're now standing courageously in worship. Their fear had been overcome by faith. Their suspicions had been taken away and replaced with surrender. Their worries were overwhelmed by worship. Will you behold the Lord Jesus this morning? Will you look upon him? And the question that came from the disciples' lips here was this: what sort of man is this? Notice with me, please. When Jesus addressed their little faith, it doesn't say it in the text, but the fact, as I said, our doubts are suspicions. Our doubts are accusations against God. Just a few moments before, they had been saying in their hearts what kind of man this was. An insufficient man. A man who wasn't worthy for them to get in that boat. A man who had let them down. A man who had disappointed them. But now look what's on their lips. Look what's on their lips, beloved. They can't answer the question anymore because their doubts have been taken away and replaced by faith. And now they can only ask the question because they see that not as he's not this small and insufficient God. He is the great God whose glory is so great. The only way to speak of him is with a question mark at the end. Because no sentence, no declaration can fully capture his glory. Who is the only question that's right as they gaze upon the infinite ocean of his majesty? Who is this? Who could this be? And throughout this text, look with me, you probably wondered, why has he bolded these little words, he, his, him, he? Notice throughout this text, Matthew has written this gospel to evangelize you. And throughout this text, even grammatically, he is begging you to name who this is. He never names Jesus in this passage. Even at places where the subject could become fuzzy, and you might start to wonder, well, who's he? He wants you to ask that. Do you see how every part of the scripture is begging you to do one thing? It's to answer this question of verse 27. Who is he? Who is he? Is he the Lord of all, or is he not? And the Holy Spirit brought this question forth from the hearts of the disciples, and he puts it to your heart this morning. Who is he? Is he the Lord of all? Will you, by faith, name him and follow him as Lord of all. Let me pray.